Hi there. Welcome to the Professor Knits podcast. I'm your host, Nikki. This is a podcast about knitting and spinning and dyeing yarn. I am going to get into things pretty quickly. I want to keep this as a fairly short episode. In 40 minutes, I have a phone call I need to make, and I don't want to miss the phone call, and this is my only chance to podcast today. And since it's been so long since my last podcast, I figure what a great way to keep me limited and not chatter too much. So I'm just going to get straight to my finished objects. I'm very excited. I'm wearing one of my finished objects. I'll stand up and give you a little bit of a looky-loo. Sorry, not the best vantage point. But this is my Baldric pullover by Isabel Kramer. And it's been done for quite some time. I finished it back in January. And I really, really love it. But as you can see, the neck is really stretching out. It's an unfinished neck, and it's really stretching out. But I don't mind. I'm kind of trying to rock, you know, the flash dance look by letting it slip off my shoulder a little bit. And I just love it. I love the color. I love the way it fits. It's a very casual look, and I've got a few problems with some of my, like this is, as you can see right here, here's an example right under my arm. This is not a mistake. This is just how the yarn knitted up. And I've talked a little bit about the yarn in my previous episodes. This is a Noro silk lamb's wool merino blend. I'll put the information down below because I didn't bring the extra skein here with me. But it was a very luxurious blend in an Erin weight. But as I've mentioned before, it almost had this hand-spun quality where it was thick and thin. And I've noticed where it is thin, it looks like there's a hole. So I'm not too wild about that, but I'm going with it. It's a nice casual look. It's got the garter detailing on the sleeve and on the sides, and it's very comfortable. I've worn it quite a bit in the last few months. So overall, I'm very happy. I would never knit with this yarn again, unfortunately, but I would definitely make another Baldric pullover in maybe a little bit more of a rustic yarn. I think it would look really nice, or maybe a cotton wool blend. Definitely not this yarn again, but the color is amazing. I love the color. So overall, very happy, and I'll post the information in terms of the yarn I used and links to the pattern in the description box below. I don't do show notes. I've tried, and I'm not that organized. I just sort of fly by the seat of my pants and tend to forget to give people information. So if there's anything I forget to put down below, because this is all just for fun for me, right? So if there's anything I forget to tell you and you want to know about, please feel free to ask me, either message me here through YouTube or visit my website. I forgot to give you my information, MedusaYarn.com. And I'm also on Ravelry as Medusa Yarn. I'm pretty much everywhere now on social media as Medusa Yarn. Medusa Yarn is my yarn company that I'll talk about in a bit. And except for my podcast is The Professor Knits, and I'm still The Professor Knits on Instagram. So sorry, I should have mentioned that at the beginning. So my second second finished object is my Grocery Girl shawl. Now this is the second Grocery Girl shawl I've made. I really, really love this shawl. I love the size of it, the shape of it. I just find it's the perfect size shawl. It's not too much shawl for a nice sort of wraparound look. So I'm very pleased with it, and I'm keeping this one for myself. I haven't blocked it yet, but I'm really quite happy with the way it looks unblocked. So I'm in no rush to block it, especially here in Knoxville. It's starting to get pretty warm, so I'm probably not going to get a whole lot of use out of this shawl till the fall. So I'm in no rush to block it. But it's just a gorgeous pattern. I've always loved this pattern by Hohe Locatelli. The yarn was a dream to knit with, and it is by Oink Pigments. And my last episode, episode 11, was a quick little interview with Elena, one of the owners and founders of Oink Pigments. And so if you've never heard about them, be sure to check them out, oinkpigments.com. And this is their bamboo wool nylon base, the jewel base, which was really nice, and the bamboo adds a really nice sheen to it. The gray color here is silver lining, and the purple colorway is the grape escape. And I don't know if anybody ever experiences this, but every once in a while, I will knit with a yarn that makes me hungry. And that's exactly what was happening with this particular shade of grape. It just made me kind of want grape juice or eat grapes. I don't know. I'm a real weirdo when it comes to things like that. But tell me if anything like that has ever happened to you. And it doesn't happen often. I think this is only like the second time it's ever happened. But I wanted to eat this yarn. That's how pretty the shade is. And it's just the perfect, it describes grape perfectly. I wanted like a grape popsicle or grape anything. Wine, of course, but that's every day. I don't need to be knitting for that. Love it. I highly recommend the yarn, and I will always highly recommend the Grocery Girl shawl, or the Girl from the Grocery Girl, the Girl from the Grocery Store shawl by Hohe Locatelli. Highly recommend it. So that's two finished objects that I have, and so I should. It's been long enough, right? So let's move on to whips. And I don't mean to rush a little bit, but I do have a lot to talk about in the next, 35 minutes, so I'm going to move right along. Now, let me first of all talk about my socks. I have several whips that are languishing that I'm not going to mention. I'm only going to talk about two active whips that I have right now. And the first is another pair of vanilla socks. And I realized just how boring I'm getting. Like, every pair of socks I show you guys is another pair of vanilla socks. And they're a bit of a mess right now because I just was knitting on them earlier. But two at a time, toe up, magic loop, my usual. I'll just show you one. I'm in the process of turning the heel on the right foot. And I'm enjoying it because it's a no-brainer. I can knit these now without a pattern. And I'm doing the heel flap and gusset. But I'm getting kind of bored of vanilla socks, and I realize it's time for me to branch out and do some more pattern socks. I've only ever done one pair of pattern socks, the Mercury socks. So my next pair will be pattern socks. And there's so many to choose from. So many wonderful patterns out there that have just been released recently. So I'm going to have to take a look and see what I want to knit. So the basic vanilla sock, the yarn is actually my own hand-dyed yarn on my 75 superwash merino 25% nylon base. And it's a beautiful speckled yarn. It's got all sorts of sort of light red, pink, almost orange, brown, and black speckles. And I'm kind of kicking myself. Here's how it looks balled up. I remember speckling. I think this was one of the first yarns I tried speckling. And I didn't know what I was doing. And I hated it. I thought it was really ugly. But I still steamed it and set it and threw it into my stash. And it wasn't quite 100 grams, so I wasn't going to post it on my Etsy shop. And I didn't like it at all. I thought it was a big failure. And then I was looking for, some yarn to do another pair of socks. So I was going through my sock yarn, and I pulled it out, and I thought, I'll just knit this and get rid of it. And I love the way it's knitting up. And I guess it goes to show, never judge a skein until you've knitted with it. And I'm loving it. And I think I can remember the colors I used, and I think I'm going to try to reproduce it. But that was up in Vermilion, where we had hard water. Here in Knoxville, I mean, I doubt I'm going to get the same thing, but that's okay. But I really like it. I think it's quite a nice, like, I would do a sweater in this. Like, I'm not a big fan of really high contrast speckles, but I do like this. So that's my first work in progress, another pair of vanilla socks. Now, my second work in progress. I can't speak today. Okay, I'm going to stop rushing, right? The phone call, if I'm a few minutes late, not a big deal. I'm the one calling her, so she can wait 5 minutes. Anyways, the next one is a sweater that I had started and had planned on finishing for Ravelenix. If you don't know what Ravelenix is, it's held during the Olympics where you cast on a project, a sizable project, and you finish it while the Olympics are going on. So you start it during the opening ceremonies and you close it and you finish it before the closing ceremonies. And my friend Meredith and I chose Wintersall by Jennifer Steingass, and I'll put a picture here. Beautiful, beautiful sweater. Her designs are really popular right now, and her style is very distinct. I think it's, well, there's all sorts of different patterns that she has out right now, but this spiky looking evergreen tree is very distinct in her yokes right now. Now, I cast on, Meredith and I got together for the opening Olympics, and I cast on and we were off to the races. And I'll talk about my yarn in just a second. But what happened is, and I'll show you what I have. I've got most of it done. But the way in which this particular pattern is written is you start with a provisional cast on right below the color work. And then you knit up. And then when you're finished, you then go back, put the provisional stitches back onto your needles, and then knit the body. And as you can see, you knit the sleeves at the end. And no problem, it was knit in the round, I cast on, I was going great guns, and I got, I don't know, it was about 3 or 4 inches up the yoke when I realized that I had twisted my stitches when I joined in the round. That never happens to me. I never twist my stitches. I just about cried. And this is a woolen spun yarn. It's a rustic yarn. And there was no way I could unravel that kind of color work. So I just cut the yarn and started over. And then it happened again. I twisted my stitches again. But I'd only been maybe an inch into the project. I don't know how this kept happening. So I had to cast it on a third time. And this was, at this point, we were already about 3 days into the Olympics. So I was thinking, oh, I don't know if I'm going to be able to do this. But I was heading up to Canada for a couple weeks. I thought I'll finish it up there. So anyways, I went up to Canada. I cast it on again for a third time, ensured there was no twisted stitches, and everything was fine. I did most of the work while I was up in Canada. I didn't finish, as you can see, before the Olympics closed. But I really enjoyed knitting it. I'm on Sleeve Island, and I will finish them soon. But again, now that the warm weather is kicking in, it's harder to sit down to knit this kind of stuff. But it was just a beautiful pattern, this color work. It's not my best knitting. I did make a bit of a mistake after I was finished the yoke and it was time to go back and put the live stitches off of the waste yarn onto the needles. I was a little rushed and I was visiting with family. I was visiting with my Auntie Diane, who's my knitting guru, and we were just talking knitting and talking about the sweater, and I got a little sloppy and I twisted a couple of the stitches and missed a couple. So it's not my best knitting. I can see where that provisional cast on was. Maybe nobody else can see it, but it's worse on the back. I don't mind showing my mistakes, right? You can see right in here. It was just sloppy and rushed. But that's the back of the sweater, so I'll never see it once it's done. And if anybody's that close that they can see and that they care, then I don't care, right? Good for them. Anyway. The yarn. Let's talk about the yarn. This is Holst yarn, or Holst Garn, the Danish yarn that everybody and their dog is knitting with. I have to say, I am so pleased with this yarn. I ordered it from Denmark, and it arrived in less than a week to the US, and then I ordered so much because this is the super soft fingering weight, the jumper weight, two-ply jumper weight. And I was nervous, so I ordered and so I was going to hold two strands. I've held two strands together to gain the worsted weight, which is what the pattern calls for. So I ordered way too much because I was nervous about running out of yarn. And I was convinced I was going to finish in time and that I would need as much yarn, all the yarn I possibly could. I didn't want to have to order more halfway through because then I wouldn't finish in time for the Olympics. I didn't finish anyway. And it was so affordable. I'm telling you, with shipping, with way too much yarn, like look at, I'm done the body, all I have to do the sleeves, and I still have a cone like this for the main color. I still have these two balls, and I'm done the color work, right? All in, less than $50, probably even less than $40. I think it went up over $40 with the shipping, which was completely reasonable considering it was an international shipping. So I couldn't be happier with this yarn. It is very rustic, and people talk about the spinning wheel. I can't feel anything, but I did wash my swatch, and I could see it blooming. So I'm really excited. I really like the yarn. I'll definitely be knitting with it again in the future. So the colors, the main color, the body, the one in Jennifer Steingass's example, let's do the right side so you can't see that big mistake, is more of a robin's egg. I decided to go with something a little darker. So my main blue is the marlin, and I think it's a little bit more turquoise in real life. It's showing up very blue on my monitor. It's a little bit greener, aquamarine-y greener in real life. So that's my main color. And then the contrast color, so that was the marlin colorway in the super soft. And then I went with the slate gray for my contrasting colors, which is really kind of a nice dark, not quite charcoal gray, but a nice dark slate gray. And then my other contrasting color is the silver gray. So really nice complementary colors, and I'm really, really loving it. I can't remember which size I knitted. It goes A, B, C, D, I think. I can't remember. I'll put it below if anybody cares. And Sleeve Island, I'm full on Sleeve Island, but I'll get off of it soon. I'm not allowed to cast on any more projects until, any more sweaters until this is done. And I'm very excited to get to my next Kate Davies design sweater, so I need to get this finished. Now I'm going to talk a little bit about spinning. So let's start with this. This is something I spun up, and this is a very special skein of yarn. This one actually isn't for sale because it's the first skein of yarn from my Romney fleece that I purchased at the Southeastern Fiber Festival, or Fiber Fair, Animal Fiber Fair last October. Out in Asheville, North Carolina. So I've talked about this before. I bought a 7-pound Romney fleece, and I've been washing it, drying it, combing it, and spinning it ever since. And it's a process, and it's because I have so many other hobbies that I like to do, it's taking some time. But I did get this done, and this is the natural color. It's kind of a nice gray with hints of brown in it. And it's as close as I could get to a 2-ply jumper weight, so a fingering weight. And it is woolen spun. I did, because when I was carding the fiber, I was making sure all of the fibers were going in different directions, creating the roll lag. And then when I was spinning this, I did a bit of a long draw and made sure it was a woolen spun as good as I could because it was my first time doing a woolen spun, and then it's 2-ply. So I'm really, really excited. And I haven't dyed it yet. I'm not sure if I'm going to. And I think what I will do is once I get through the entire fleece, which is 7 pounds of fiber, I'm thinking about matching sweaters for my family. Or who knows, maybe I'll sell it. I don't know, but I'm not ready to part with it yet. We'll see. But man, it just is this beautiful, rustic, I love it so much. So I'm very proud of this because it's the first rustic yarn that I've spun that isn't ropey. It's quite soft. It's got a little bit of bite to it. I wouldn't want to wear it next to my skin as a sweater, but it's I'm definitely proud of this. My spinning is getting a lot better. The other skein I want to show you is this here, which is also a fingering weight, 2-ply. And this is 100% Rambouillet, which is a French Merino sheep breed. Really soft. I really, really like spinning the Rambouillet. I have more of it. This is just one. I have 2 skeins, but I'll just show you one. And what I like about this too is that I dyed the fiber first. So I purchased the Rambouillet from Kristen's Fiber, I think. I'll put it down below. Again, at SAF last October. And I dyed the roving, or dyed the fiber, this beautiful purpley mauve color. And then I spun it up and plied it. And here we go. And it's really soft and beautiful. And I'll probably be selling this. It isn't on my Etsy shop yet, because I'm stockpiling some stuff, because I'm selling at some fiber fairs coming up. Well, I might as well just talk about that right now. As you guys, my regular viewers know, I started a yarn company called Medusa Yarn and Fiber. And I vended for the first time last fall at the Murfreesboro Fiber in the Borough. And I had a great time. People loved my yarn and bought it. I couldn't believe it. And so I've decided to do a few more fiber festivals. So if you're in the East Tennessee, Kentucky, Carolinas region, and you're within driving distance, I'll be vending at the Smoky Mountain Fiber Arts Festival in Townsend, right at the foothills of the Smoky Mountains in East Tennessee, April 20th to 22nd. So I'll be there. And then I'll be vending in May at the Kentucky Sheep and Fiber Festival up in Lexington, Kentucky, May 19th and 20th. So I'm going to be stockpiling my hand spun as well as my hand dyed yarn and making stitch markers and things like that. So if you're interested in, you live in the area and you're going to any of those fiber fairs, please drop by and say hello. This isn't hand spun yarn. It's yarn I've purchased from suppliers. But I've just had a lot of fun with variegation and gradient dyeing. And so here's an example of a colorway that I've named. Sorry, I've got little specks of dust on here. Which is my first colorway that I've actually thought about and conceptualized. Instead of just having fun in the dye pot or speckling or see what happens. This, I wanted to do a variegated, sort of gradiated, dark blue. And I don't think you can really tell on the camera, but this is actually on a sparkle base, a silver stellina sparkle base. But they're very subtle. It's only 5% and it's very subtle. But this represents my first official colorway that I conceptualized, and it's called Chaos. Because in Greek mythology, sorry, this isn't my label, this is just my inventory tag, which I will remove. This is chaos, which to me, when I was thinking about Greek mythology and colorways, chaos represents the primordial void from which all creatures, living creatures, came. And I was thinking about chaos, and I wanted to dye a color that represented the darkness, the vastness, the randomness, but wasn't evil or menacing or too confusing. Because chaos, I think in our modern, I'm getting way too philosophical about this. I know, if you're rolling your eyes at me, I totally get it. I was rolling my eyes at myself, so I'm with you on that. But this is who I am. Where was I? Oh. Dark, vast, empty. I wanted to avoid purple because I have other plans for some purple. I want to keep it cool and dark, but not evil or menacing. And so that's what the dark blue represents, that void. Oh, I know what I was going to say. Our modern connotation with chaos is a negative thing, but that's not the way it originated. It was just meant random sort of emptiness that was disorganized, but not necessarily a bad thing. So anyway, back to the point. The dark blue represents the vast void of darkness. The lighter blue throughout represents the spark of life, the promise of life about to come. And if I have this dyed on my 100% superwash merino fingering, but I also have it on this silver stellina. And on the silver stellina, because the silver stellina is so faint and so subtle, it's there, but it's so faint and subtle. For me, for my concept, it kind of represents a hint at the cosmos and the stars that are about to be created. So it's not yet cosmic, but it's gonna be, okay? I won't ramble on too much longer about how I came up with these colorways. The other one I had thought about and produced was Eros. Again, a gradiated sort of pinkish colorway, pinkish reddish. And Eros, of course, is one of the early forces in the universe that came out of chaos, and it's sort of a feminine force, but I'm not going to go on and on about it. This is available on my 100% superwash sock base. A few others, Andromeda, a bright pink. It's very reminiscent of my Ken Cald colorway, but a little bit more variegated. And this one, now moving completely away from Greek mythology and more into the realm of living in football culture in East Tennessee. This one is called Volunteer. It's a variegated orange, as you can tell for all four of these. I was very much following the same dye technique with different colors, right? Obvious. It's not my only technique, but it was the one I was playing with the most recently. So if you are living in the East Tennessee area, you know why this is called Volunteer. Or if you are a college football fan, you know why this is called Volunteer. Now, I am not a football fan. I'm a hockey girl, hockey and lacrosse. I'm Canadian through and through. But I do recognize that I live in East Tennessee. UT Vol, Big Orange, Big Ideas is very important. And a lot of people really, really love this color. So I decided if I'm going to be vending in East Tennessee or even just across the border into Kentucky, maybe I shouldn't bring these to Kentucky with me. But here in East Tennessee, I suspect these will be well received. Maybe not. And this is on my gold stellina as well. Volunteer. All right. Now, before I move on to a few other things, I want to briefly talk about my cowl. My knit my way through Inspired by Ilay knit along that I have happening over at Medusa Yarn at my Ravelry page. Because I'm a huge fan of Kate Davies, so I've created this knit along. I got a lot of interest in it initially, and then I stopped working on it. I stopped communicating with people. Completely my fault. So my big plan was to have a giveaway each month for any finished object by Kate Davies' book, Inspired by Ilay. And you could keep re-entering the same projects until you win. So it was going to be a really laid-back cowl. I haven't done a whole lot with it because I was away in Canada. And then the flu worked its way through my house, and school kept getting canceled because of the flu and bad weather. So I didn't do a whole lot of administrative type stuff. But it is still happening, and I am going to get things updated. But I did pick a winner, a random winner, for the January finished object. I think there was about 10 entries, so that's pretty good for my first cowl, and such a specific cowl. And I'll announce the winner. It was number 4, Isabel E.S., and she won for her Ardmore Gansey, the male, the sweater for the man. Just a beautiful object, finished object. So please head over if you're a member, please join if you're not, and if you already are a member, head over and take a look at some of the finished objects. So Isabel, please message me either through Ravelry or here through YouTube, and we can connect. And I was originally going to give away a skein of yarn, the Black Cherry colorway, and that's still on the table along with a stitch marker. But because I was so late and disorganized for kicking off this cowl properly, you can just head on over to my Etsy shop and pick a skein of whatever you like. So it doesn't have to be the black cherry. The black cherry is there if you want it, but there's a lot of other stuff, and there's different bases, different weights, and they range from $20 to $30. Anything is you can have whatever you like. And I will match up a stitch marker to go with it, or you can go with the original stitch marker, whatever you like. So that's sort of my apology for not being a little bit better organized with this cowl. I've picked up sewing again. And I know what you're thinking. You might be rolling your eyes thinking, oh gosh, here's another knitter who's also going to sew. And I did used to sew years and years ago, but I was never very proficient at it. And I kept returning back to it and trying, but I would never stick with it. And my husband had bought me this beautiful, really high quality, uniquely you dress form that I've never used because I got pregnant and I stopped sewing. So I decided, I was looking at my daughter the other day and I was thinking, I want to be able to knit her, and my son, but more so my daughter. I want to be able to knit her sew her anything she wants. Whether it's a princess costume or a Batman costume or her prom dress or whatever. I just really like the idea of being able to do that. So I dusted off the sewing machine and I'm kind of like a beginner again. But I did make two skirts in the last couple weeks. Very basic skirts. So I have two finished objects. This is one. A basic A-line skirt with some darts and just some fabric I picked up at Joann's. My 50% off coupon. I'm not ready to start buying good quality fabric yet. And of course, the first fabric I picked up, I cut wrong, right? I laid out the pattern pieces incorrectly, you know, all sorts of, like being a second time beginner is sometimes worse than being a first time beginner because you have just enough confidence to think you know what you're doing. Anyways, everything worked out really well. I got the darts. It fits perfectly. I got the zipper set in really nice. You can hardly see it. I haven't done the eye hook yet. I don't think I left enough fabric at the top. As you can see, it's a very recent finished object. I haven't trimmed up all the loose threads, and I still have to tack the inside facing in. But I loved it, and it fits perfectly, which means I don't have to lose weight. I don't have to go to the gym anymore. I can just make myself clothes that fit. Let's face it, I haven't worn a pair of jeans in like 2 years, and I'm kind of starting to miss it. But anyways, the one thing I wasn't too happy about is my hem. I went for a blind hem, and in some places, I did it perfect. Perfect blind hem. Can see, right in here it's a perfect blind hem, and then I messed up and it's no longer a blind hem. So I still have a lot of practicing to do, and until I get better, I'll still be buying the cheapo fabric from Joann's. But the most exciting thing is that it fits. And I had made another one, the exact same pattern, but I made it in this navy denim with this embossed anchors on it. And I actually made this one first, and it's in the laundry. I wore it, I've already worn it so much. But it was a big rookie mistake to choose this first because everything worked out perfectly until I got to the hem, because these embossed anchors are quite raised, and so they don't, if you end up with one of them where you need to fold, they kind of mess up everything. And so that happened a couple times in the hemline. So the hemline is just a hideous mess. But I don't care, right? No one's looking that close at my hem, and it was the first time. But I was really impressed with it. Happy that I could sew two skirts that fit me perfectly, that are wearable, comfortable, and all in cost me less than $20 because I'm a bargain shopper. I'm going to probably take some leftover fabric and make my daughter matching skirts. We'll see. It's kind of hard to make a skirt for a two-year-old, though. She turned two a couple weeks ago, so that's very exciting. Okay, so I feel like I've gone a little bit off the rails here at the end, trying to rush to get finished in time. But I think I covered everything I wanted to cover. And I have to say thank you for those of you who are still watching. I have 160 subscribers, which I know is very low, but I'm so happy that I have you guys. I really appreciate it. I did have 162 subscribers and I lost two. I don't know what happened. I don't know what I did or said. Or maybe it's because I don't produce enough videos. I don't know. But I hope that if you are a subscriber and you have been watching, that you continue to do so. I really appreciate it. I enjoy doing this. I enjoy all aspects of it. So please, if you haven't subscribed, please do. Get me back up to 162 subscribers. So take care. Have enjoy your Easter if you celebrate Easter, or Passover if you celebrate Passover, or nothing if you celebrate nothing, whatever. Just enjoy spring, because it's I think it's going to be a good one. So take care.